pray that, Lord, open up the deep revelations and the treasures of your word and voice and speak to our heart. Father God, let your word come alive in its great power and anointing. And Lord, this morning we want to be blessed by your word. We want to hear your still small voice. Holy Spirit, cover this place and all of us with the anointing of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, speak to us through your word and encourage us. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Today, this morning, we are going to focus on, is anything too hard for the Lord? Is anything too hard for the Lord? And this question is being asked by God Himself. You see? It is the Lord asking this question. In verse 14, Genesis 18:14, is anything too hard for the Lord? I will return to you at the appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son. You see, Abraham was having his own doubts. He had so many doubts. And even he was preparing for another options, you see. Because in those days, you see, they need to have a hire, you see. And he was preparing Eliezer to be his hire. Because he was not sure. He was almost 100 years old. Sarah was about 90. How can they have a son, you see, to be their hire? We read in verses 11 and 12. Abraham and Sarah were already old and well advanced in years. And Sarah was past the age of childbearing. See, it was impossible, humanly speaking. Medically speaking and scientifically, totally impossible. And when God is saying in verse 14, is anything hard for the Lord? For the Lord, nothing is hard. This is very true. Very true, nothing is hard for the Lord. And Bible says there in verse 12, Sarah laughed to herself. She thought, after I am worn out and my master is old, will I now have this pleasure? And then verse 17, Abraham fell face down. He laughed and said to himself, will a son be born to a man 100 years old? Will Sarah bear a child at the age of 90? Is it God had made them to laugh? They were not happy of not having a hire, you see. But God made them to laugh. That's why they named their son Isaac. Isaac means God has made us to laugh, you see. God has made us glad with laughter. God did it. When Abraham had all his doubts, God said, is there anything too hard for the Lord? And the answer is, no, nothing is too hard for God, you see. For Lord, nothing is hard. Why? Because He is the Creator and the Maker. He is the Creator and the Maker, and He can do anything. He can make us glad. He can heal us. He can make us joyful. He can make us rejoicing. And so there are no promises that are too hard for the Lord to fulfill. First thing, there are no promises in the Bible that are too hard for the Lord to fulfill. He can fulfill. We read in Bible there are 30,000 promises. How many? 30,000 promises. More than 900 you can claim for a day, see? So many promises God has given. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 20. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 20. For no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. And so through Him, they are amen. You see, all the promises of God in Christ Jesus are yes. Yes. Man-made promises are sometimes no. Sometimes man-made promises are lies. But God-given promises are always yes in Christ Jesus. Isn't that amazing? Then yes in Christ Jesus. Let's read 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. 2 Peter chapter 1 And verse 4. See what kind of promises God has given. Though this He has given us is very great and precious promises. Amazing, isn't it? God has given very great promises and very precious promises. God has given very great promises and precious promises. God never changes His mind. God is not a liar and He never lies. And the promises that God has given are very great, you see. Promises of God are so great, which means if He fulfills them, you can be blessed greatly. He can do great things for you. He can do great miracles for you. Because His promises are very great. That is what the Bible says. When people make promises, they make small promises. You know that? They make small promises. Okay, I'll give you $100 or I'll do that small thing for you or something like that. Their promises are small. But God's promises are great. And when He fulfills His promise, He does a great wonder. He does a great miracle. He does a great miracle. Let me tell you. He does a great miracle. And we read in Numbers 23 verse 19. Numbers 23 verse 19. God is not a man that He should lie, nor a son of man that He should change His mind. See that? God is not a man that He should lie, nor a son of man that He should change His mind. Does He speak and then not act? Does He promise and not fulfill? Yes, He fulfills. He is not a liar. He fulfills His promises. God does it. It's a wonderful thing. God's promises are great. And He does great things. You know, some years back, when God asked me to come to the United States, you see, I had no immigrant visas. You see, nobody can file for me and bring me here. I was in India, I was pastoring a church, and I was pastoring a very large church. And there was a great revival going on in that church. Many miracles and this whole night prayer meetings will be packed with 200 people. 200 people praying all night. Think of that. Such great power of God will move that there will be so many miracles. So many Hindus coming to Christ, you see. And there was a great revival going on. And then, one day two pastors showed up to my office. They were also an anointed man of God and they said, Pastor, it is now time for you to leave this church. I said, what? It is time for you to leave this church and go. I said, I will not leave this big church with so much revival and miracles and preaching of God's word. And I will not go. And they said, no, God has showed us that you got to go. And so I told them, see, God hasn't shown me yet. And I don't believe what you say. I'm not going, I said. Then 6 months passed. And one day God showed me in the dream that I need to go. And God told me that I have used you enough. And I have some other plans for your life. You have to go. And so I was just worried, you see. I was in a comfortable zone with a large church, with revival and miracles and preaching of so much word of God. And then God is saying, you got to leave. And I said, I need to start over again. You see, how am I going to do that? And how will I go? You see, I don't have any immigrant visas to the United States or anything like that. And then I went for to inaugurate one brother in a church had established a factory, you see. And so he called me to do the inauguration of that factory. So I went to that factory, I was doing the inauguration. And then the Lord spoke to my heart from one verse. that He can do beyond what we can imagine or what we can ask for. By the anointing of the power of the Holy Spirit, this verse is in the New Testament. He can do great things beyond what I can ask or imagine through the anointing of the Holy Spirit that is on me. See, He can do that. And I was convinced by that verse. And so I went to see my boss right away. After I came from there, I had a bishop on me, and so I went to see him. And I said, I need to get your permission and leave to go to the United States. And so he granted me the leave and the permission. When I have to come to the United States, I will come on visitor's visa, okay? And when you come on visitor's visa, you have a temporary time frame. You do your visit and they put a stamp in your passport. By that date, you have to go back. You have to go back. And so I came with my bag and with my things. With faith, I'm not going back. Will you believe that? God has sent me, and so I came with faith, you see, with my bag over here. You won't believe, very next day, one of the Bible colleges called me and gave me the position of a dean in the Bible college. Because this is God's doing, you see. This is God's doing, and God's miracle, He had called me, you see. And then Bible college right away sponsored me to live in this country, to stay in this country, and to teach the word of God. You see, when God calls, when He promises, He can fulfill it. See? But you have to walk out by faith, you see. You have to trust Him. You have to go on the limb, thinking, now see, my son and my wife are back home. How they are going to come now? How will they join me? See? It's a very big question. But God can do that. Let's go further. If you read in Joshua chapter 2, you see, there is in Joshua chapter 2, there is the man called Joshua, the man of God, and he comes with the people of Israel before the walls of Jericho. See? And when he comes to Jericho, you see, they were very huge walls, and it was lying in their path as they were moving towards the promised land. These walls were standing in their path. How that Jericho could be removed, you see. And so God gave them the guidance that they have to praise and worship the Lord and march around those walls and sing worship and praise to the Lord. You see, the praise and worship to the Lord done from the depth of your heart brings down the presence of God. And when the presence of God comes down, He can uproot anything that is in your path. You see, He can. And another thing that God had promised in regarding those Jericho walls, on the top of that walls was the house of a woman named Rahab. God had promised that I'm going to save Rahab. Why? Because she had helped the people of Israel. And so God wanted to save Rahab. If God is going to save Rahab, then how? What is going to happen to these walls of Jericho? If the walls of Jericho are going to fall, then family of Rahab will get destroyed. See, there is an impossibility in this promise. There is an impossible situation. How God can fulfill this promise? But God is God. Nothing is too hard for the Lord. The walls of Jericho fell down, but the part where the Rahab's house was on the wall did not fall. Think of that. God can do impossible things. He can make it possible. And Rahab was saved, you see. And people took over the city of Jericho and they went further. Then we come to 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 2 to 16. 1 Kings chapter 2, 17, verses 2 to 16. And here we find a man of God called Elijah. And Elijah was asked to pray that it should not rain. And when it doesn't rain, then it's going to cause famine. And Elijah prayed and the rain stopped and there was no rain for a few years, you see. Almost more than 3 years now. And Elijah was being persecuted by King Ahab. King Ahab would kill him for such kind of prayer, you see. And so Ahab was looking for Elijah. While Elijah was being sheltered under the refuge of the living God, and Elijah was asked to leave near a brook of Cherith, and there the ravens were commanded to bring Elijah meat and bread. Now ravens by nature are such birds that are greedy, you know that? They will eat away all meat and bread. They will not bring it to Elijah. But God is a God, you see. From impossibility, He can make things possible. These ravens are impossible birds. Yet, God used them to bring Elijah meat and bread in the morning and in the evening. And fed Elijah. See, there are impossible things that stand in our way of miracles. They stand in the way of our miracles. But you have to believe God. Elijah believed God. He did not have to believe ravens. Does he have to believe ravens? If he tried to believe ravens, he would know that these crows will by nature never bring bread and meat to him. But he believed God. And Bible says that God kept bringing food for Elijah through these impossible creatures. And then one day the famine was so hard that even that brook of Cherith dried out. And when it dried out, God is asking Elijah, move on. You cannot settle down in Cherith, you see. God removes our comfortable zones at times, you see. And ask him to move on and go to Zarephath. And go to Zarephath. Was he sending him to a rich man's house? No. God was sending Elijah to Zarephath at the home of a poor widow. And the poor widow had not any food actually. A little oil, a little flour, and they were planning to make bread. Son and mother would eat it and die. That's it. That was their plan. So limited plan, you know. Our plans are always limited. But God had some great plans if they believe. And man of God like Elijah was sent to be taken care of by this poor widow. What this poor widow is going to give him? Nothing. And yet when Elijah appeared to their door at their home, you see, Elijah said, what are your plans? She said, these are my plans. Okay. Before you carry out your plan, first make a piece of bread and bring it to me as an offering to God. Bring it to me as an offering to God. Means they have to 100% now. Whatever they had, little oil and little flour, even that, they had to give it away as an offering to God, you see. And you are men of God. It was a very hard thing, very difficult. The widow had to lay aside her plans of making a bread and eating for herself and her son. Instead giving it away as an offering to God. But she did it. She believed it. And what happened? Bible says that oil never ran out, you see. The flour vessel never emptied for many, many months, you see. She and her family continue to eat out of it. Eat out of it. God can do it. His promises are great. Though they look impossible on the surface, the Lord can fulfill them. When He fulfills it, nothing is impossible to God. Nothing is impossible to God. Then we read that when we read here in, you see, there is no prayer that is too hard for the Lord. That is my second point, you see. There is no prayer for the Lord to answer, you see. If you believe the Lord, and if you bring a prayer to the Lord, believing in Him and having faith in Him, He is able to answer that prayer, you see. And He is able to work a miracle for you. Jeremiah chapter 33 verse 3. Jeremiah 33 verse 3. Call to me, and I will answer you, and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know. Call unto me, and the Lord will tell you the things that you have not known beforehand. Things that you do not know, He can reveal it to you. You know, on Thursday evening, I was talking with Kathy, and Kathy had a very huge situation in her kitchen with the sink drain being clogged for many days, and it was such a hard thing. And David cannot help her in this situation, and she used to pray, you see. They did not call any plumber, you see. David said there is no need to call a plumber. And she keep on pumping with that pump to open the drain. And God spoke to her in her heart, "My grace is sufficient for you. My grace is sufficient for you." She had to keep believing that promise. And that word of God, she continued to hang on to that promise. Look, a very impossible situation. Kept on pumping the drain of the sink. Finally, the Lord opened those clogs miraculously, that even some old clogs were also opened. That is what she says. Even the old clogs were opened. When God works a miracle, He works a mighty miracle. He can do a better job, you see? He can. He can. We read here in John chapter 16 and verse 23. See what God promises. The Lord promises, "In that day you will no longer ask me anything. I tell you the truth, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name." Ask in the name of Jesus. Because the name of Jesus is very powerful. The name of Jesus is very, very powerful. Ask in the name of Jesus, and my Father will do it for you. Very true. In every situation, in every circumstances, God is inviting you to pray. Pray. Claim His promises. And God will fulfill His promises for your life. He will. Nothing is too hard for the Lord. Nothing is too hard for the Lord. The third thing. There is no problem too hard for the Lord to solve. There is no problem for the Lord to solve. We read in Luke chapter 5 verses 1 to 8. Simon Peter, he toiled all night trying to fill his nets with fish. Bible declares he had not a single catch. He even never caught even one single fish. All night he toiled with his partners. They came empty handed. When Jesus climbed onto the boat of Simon Peter, He promised him something. "Why don't you take your boats into the place I show you in the sea?" And Simon complained, "Lord, I have toiled all night, and I am a fisherman who has been on these seas long, long time before you, you see. I know every corner of the sea. You are a carpenter, you are not even a fisherman." But he knew Jesus was the Lord, the carpenter who created the heavens and the earth. He is a great carpenter, you see, who created the oceans and the seas. And so Peter said, he confessed, "Lord, I believe. Let's go to the place which you show me." And they went to the place where the Lord took them, and the Lord said, cast your nets. And what happened? They caught such a huge amount of fish that their nets were about to break. See, Jesus fulfilled his promise, isn't it? He cared, see. You got to believe in him and pray to him. And he can do it, you see. He can solve your difficult problem. We read in Exodus chapter 14, verses 13 to 31. Exodus 14, 13 to 31. You see, the Israelites came to the Red Sea. And the Red Sea was lying in their path. And they were being trapped by the Pharaoh's army from all sides. And so there was a certain death. If they tried to go back, they'd be slaughtered by the Pharaoh and his armies. And so, and in the front was the Red Sea. Where can they go? But the Lord can make a way where there is no way. He can make a way to the place where there is no way. See, where there is no solution, he can give you a solution. He can work a miracle. The Lord divided the Red Sea and made a path for them to travel on that dry ground of the Red Sea. Think of that. There were walls of water on both sides. You know how many people came out of Egypt? How many Israelites? 3 million. Think of that. 3 million. How can 3 million people cross the Red Sea? If they walk two by two in one line, then it will take more than a month for them to cross the Red Sea. How wide did the Red Sea was dried up by the Lord? 3 miles. How much? 3 miles wide was dried up. That the whole 3 million can walk through at a time, all together. Think of that. Isn't that amazing? Our God is an amazing God. Our God is an amazing God. And so, my friends, there are so many stories in the Bible. All these things that happened in the Bible is to tell us the fourth thing, that he can do what he did in the Bible. All these things are written in the Bible. All these promises and miracles that God did for the people in the Bible, he can do it for you today. He can do it for you today. He can. Remember that. Nothing is impossible for you, for God to do it. If God divided the Red Sea in the Old Testament, he can divide your Red Sea and make a way for you. There is nothing too hard for the Lord. He can do it for you. Today God can uproot any Jericho walls that are standing in your way and stopping your progress. He can uproot those walls and he can make a way for you. He can. You know, when I came to the United States, I began working as a dean in that Bible college. What about my wife and son? How are they going to join me? You know what God gave me to pray? Just pray this thing, he said. Lord, just like you divided the Red Sea and took the Israelites to the promised land, you divide the Red Sea of the U.S. immigration and bring my wife and son. He gave me this prayer. Holy Spirit, teach Jesus what to pray. See? So I kept on praying that. You won't believe, next year, within 1 year, Joseph and Manuela joined me. He can. First time they went, they were denied the visas and they had to go back. I said, go second time. They went second time and they were granted. God can do that. And that's how Joseph joined me, and then Manuela went back again to finish her job. And when she went back, And after 3 years, when she tried to come in, you see, they said, all this way to go to United States have been closed down. Because there is now a new government in power. The government of President Obama had closed down so many immigration paths. And files had been locked down. I spent whole night in prayer asking the Lord, what are you going to do? She was crying on the phone, how am I going to come? I said, see, if the Lord brought me here, he will bring you too. And during the night, in the middle of the night, the Lord woke me up and said, take a pen and a paper and write down what things I'm going to tell you now. Write this letter and write these things to the immigration officer, to the U.S. consulate in Mumbai. I wrote down that letter that was dictated by God. Next morning I went to my office and I sent an email. I sent an email to the chief of the U.S. consulate, the chief of the immigration in U.S. consulate in Mumbai. You won't believe. When God works, He works great things. Manila was traveling in a train to her job. While she was in the train, she got a phone call from the U.S. consulate in Mumbai. Why don't you come to U.S. consulate right away? And she said, I'm in the train. See, give me at least 24 hours. Give me one day. Because Mumbai is not near from Gujarat. You see, you got to travel by overnight train, you see. So they gave her to come at her time. And so she got down from the train, took another train, went back home, packed her things, took all the documents, and she went by night train next day to Mumbai and appeared in the U.S. consulate. No questions asked. Think of that. No questions asked. Give your passport. She gave a passport. They stamped all immigrant visas and allowed her to join us. I have not stayed even one single day or single hour illegal in this nation. Not even 1 hour also. When God does it, He can part your Red Seas. He can. I'm speaking through my own experiences with God. God can do it. You just need to believe Him and trust Him. Otherwise, if you have an experience with the immigration offices of the United States, they are impossible, let me tell you. They are the most difficult thing, most hard thing. To face them. And they have the power to arrest you and put you in prison. Because I was here in this nation and I was going, there is an immigration jail in San Pedro where they arrest the illegal people and put them behind bars. And I used to go and preach the gospel to those people. Here I am, who did not come on an immigrant visa, but going down into the immigration jail and preaching God's word. Who can do that? Only God can open those doors. God can do that. I say, God can do that. He can. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? No. You make it hard by your own self, by not believing in the Lord and by not trusting Him. Shall we pray? Let us pray in our heart. Let us thank God. Thank you, Father, for your word in Genesis chapter 18 and verse 14. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? No, Lord. Nothing is hard for you. You can fulfill the desires of my heart. You can do what you have promised. And your promises are not small promises. They are great promises. And when you fulfill them, you can do great things for us. You can do great things for me. Nothing is impossible to you. Teach me to believe in you, to believe your promises, to believe your word, and walk according to your word. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Pray in your heart. Pray for yourself. Pray for your children. Pray for your future. Pray for your family. Pray for your career. God can do it. Our loving Father, thank you, Lord. Because you are a promise-keeping God, you are a prayer-answering God, nothing is impossible to you. Nothing is too hard for the Lord, because He is the creator of the heavens and the earth. He can still divide the Red Sea and make a way from the situation where there is no way. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father. Continue to bless your people, Lord. Answer their prayers and bless them abundantly. Help them to believe you and to believe your word. We ask in Jesus' name.
Hymn 133, we'll just sing the greatness of our God.
All right.